All right, Stewart, let's do it.
First of all, thank you for doing this interview.
Thank you for having me here.
It's not too late, I hope, for you. We'll keep you awake. What was your first, like, involvement with tattooing or a tattoo or... Not the process of tattooing, but how did tattoos become in your life enough to where you actually wanted to be a tattooer?
I remember telling my French teacher at school, I was 10 or 11 years old, and I only remember this because it became an event in the class. What do you want to do when you grow up? People with doctor, and then the French teacher would translate that that profession. So what do you want to do? I want to be a nurse, I want to be this, I want to be that. Stuart, what do you want to be? I want to be a tattoo artist. How would you say that in French? Teacher was like, oh fuck, I don't know. She had to go out and find a French dictionary, come back. Presume it's not the same in America, but everyone in England at a certain age does French or German or some other European language. Come back and look, tattoo agier. That's my poor pronunciation now. But I remember 10 or 11 years old, I wanted to be a tattooer. I was just getting into heavy metal and playing guitar, and Ozzy had a tattoo across his shoulder and all this cool shit. And my dad found out. He was like, cool, because he had all military tattoos, or tattoos he got in the military. And he was like, cool, so you want to be a tattooer? All right. I think he had in his head, maybe he could fix my tattoos. Maybe he could cover them up. And since he said he would like that, but it's never really worked out. And so he was kind of supportive, which is pretty cool. He got me some books from the local library. We lived in a very small town. He had to order the books from the library. Any books on tattooing, he got them. So I think I may have seen a Tattoo Time. So it was this, maybe not actually. It'll have been around about 1986 or 7, when I was 10 or 11. And then there was this huge book. I still haven't found it, I don't know what it is, but it's the first time I saw a tattooed scrotum, which was I was too young to see that shit. But I remember this big guy, I think he had a German name, and he stood fully naked in the tattooed man stance with his fists out.
Right.
He had nipple rings, his cock pierced, and chains connecting them all, and he had scales all around his nutsack. And I was like, this is fucking crazy shit.
Oh,
like,
my God.
But for me, all at once then, I was like, oh, that's what tattooed people are like. Well, I didn't want that for myself, but I was like, okay. I didn't really think it was that weird. Everything was exotic about tattooing, including that. But look through, there's loads of cool stuff, and then there's some other books, and I kind of, it's probably the first time I read Ed Hardy's name, and left that alone for a while because everywhere that, every tattoo shop around where I lived wasn't good. I'd seen the tattoos that come out of there, and they just looked terrible, like bad lines, hardly any colour in them, and just really crappy. It was hard to get even a deliberate looking tattoo in that area. Left that alone for a while, went through school and university and college and whatever. And like every other art student, I was doing graphic design at university, which was the only way I thought I could vaguely draw for a living. And I needed to draw. I can't really do anything else. I can barely count. Just draw. So doing that, so graphic design. Yeah, I don't have a business mind, so I'll be someone's employee and it'll all work out. But I went to university to do that in York in the north of England, and went round the local tattoo shops just secretly wishing that they'd go, hey, do you want to be a tattooer? Yes, please, tattooer.
Right.
And that obviously doesn't happen. I went in there, they didn't. I wasn't going to get tattooed because they were, by what I expected, not very good. So I didn't get to do, didn't help me. So I had that same dream, which is kind of embarrassing, that I was that kid, that I see those kids come in our shop now. Eventually, I left university and got a tattoo, which which is just some random piece of shit. I just got sick of not having a tattoo. Started my professional life as a graphic designer, which I hated, not hated, but I knew that it wasn't right, and I did it for, I think, seven years.
Oh, wow.
So, but that did teach me how to look after clients, how to listen to what people want, listen to the things that they don't say when they tell you what they want, and all that kind of stuff. Kind of have to take a brief and how to work around that. And I remember a guy called Roy Tattersley in Halifax, and he was an old guy then, and he was complete old style of doing it, and I got him to do his black shit and some other crap I've got, and he was gracious enough with me, even though he was a kind of scary dude because he was older than me and I was just kind of scrawny art kid. And but he mentioned maybe having some kit to sell. My ears perked up again. Maybe this is possible. Maybe I can tattoo. I was probably 23 around about that time, but I was just starting my career as a graphic designer. Wanted to get this to work, graphic design to work, pay the bills, all the rest of it. And but it was going around in my mind. Maybe he could do it. Maybe he could do it. I think this was 98. 99, something like that. And I've been looking at tattoo magazines since I had my own money, since I stopped having an allowance for my mother, started earning money in whatever way.
Right.
So I buy tattoo magazines and I keep them all, and I ended up having to get rid of them when I moved to London, just the space in London. But I had some cool shit. You were in some of them, and all that.
Right.
The stuff we were talking about, or you were talking about when you were tattooing me the other day, all those things you did that you feel like you shouldn't have done.
Oh, God.
All those lights off.
Someone would have just been there slapping my hand. Don't do that. Do not make that chrome.
It doesn't need
Don't
to be chrome.
Don't fucking bend that thing. Why are you going to bend that? What?
Jack is straight.
Yes, exactly.
The swallow doesn't have a broken neck.
God damn it. Don't do it.
But all that was on there, and I thought it was all cool, and I pretty much liked most kind of established styles of tattooing, and it was just, I didn't really discern between them, I just liked it all. But I thought this guy was going to sell me this equipment, got some money together, went to see him, get another session on the tattoo I was getting, and he just didn't mention it, didn't bring it up. His friends were there, and I thought, if I mention this, will these guys beat me up, will they beat him up? So I just left it a while, and it was probably for the best, because I would have just scratched myself up and my friends up,
right,
in the kitchen of the crappy rented apartment I had. And I hadn't done any drawing deliberately for tattoos at that time. I thought, there's something art school makes you think, or that they instill in you in art school, that you have a vision and you are special, and the world is lucky to have your vision. And I'm going, let the world have your vision. And I had to try and beat that out of myself. Tattooing beat it out of me, because I hate those kinds of tattoos. Like we were talking about that cool flash over there.
Right.
Art school wouldn't allow anybody to appreciate that. That's naive, it's whatever, it's not accomplished, but the designs of it are impeccable, you know. It is what a tattoo is. So lucky that that didn't work out with that guy. And I'd heard of a good shop in Leeds, which is in the north of England. It was a shop, a train ride from the town I was living in. And I went to ask for this ridiculous tattoo with all this checkered shit that goes up here. And I'd seen somewhere hanky-panky sketches, drawings of Hawaiian tattoos.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd read Moby Dick, that's got the Queequeg character whose half his body is checkered and
right up.
And that stuck in my mind for a few years. Oh, that's fucking cool. I like big, bold, strong tattoos, but I didn't know anyone who could make tattoo designs look deliberate, so I tried to design them myself,
right,
or whatever. So I ended up with some things that I kind of wish I hadn't, and I went a bit too big with them. But I went to this shop, Ultimate Skin in Leeds, and tried to make an appointment. they kind of fucked up the appointment. The guy who was supposed to do it didn't want to do it. Someone went, this guy wants checkers all up his arm, all across his chest. We've got to match up. You'd be like, you know what? I don't know if I want to do that. Maybe this other guy can do this. The other guy thought, yeah, go upstairs and see Steve. So, I expected to see this burly ass, terrifying biker guy. So
Steve
took
Byrne.
It in and went up there, and there's Steve Byrne. A couple of years younger than me. We may have even been wearing the same t-shirt of the same band that we'd been to see the week before. I was like, fuck, he's someone who's, he looks like he might be my friend. This is fucking cool. And when he come, and he, it was obvious that he didn't like, he didn't make it obvious, but I could tell by the flash he had on his walls. He had stuff from Bugs and, there were some select magazines in his room that were probably, stuff from Primal Urge and things like that. And I could tell he wasn't totally stoked to be doing what I was doing, but he was applying himself. And he looked, when he came to do the tattoo, he was looking at it in a way that meant he'd give a shit. Even if it wasn't what he wanted to do, and he wasn't going to take pictures for his own folio, and he wasn't going to tell his friends how chuffed he was with this piece of work, he'd give a shit. And he'd stand back, and have me look, and he'd eye it up, and he'd squint. And he'd do the things that I'd do when I was doing my job, designing things, and see what the composition was like, and the rhythm of it, and whatever. I was like, fuck, this is the first tattoo I've ever met who gives a shit what something looks like.
Right.
The rest of the guys, you're just a walking wallet.
Right, of
and,
course. Walking wallet, that's a fucking term.
They'd just see you, awesome sit down, open up, and they'd get some of your money, and then you'd go away, and they didn't give a shit. They'd probably want to do a clean tattoo, but they didn't really care about, they'd put any extra in. So a friendship with Steve came up from that. And then he introduced me to the whole world of what tattooing is and can be. I'd already, there's maybe five tattooers I knew of. I knew of Ed Hardy before I met Steve. I knew of Grime. I knew of Philip Liu, Tintin, and probably Paul Booth. And then anyone
not
who
a
was
bad one in the bunch.
Yeah, probably Bill Salmon as well. And anyone who was in, is it Modern Primitives. That was
right.
The only real book I could
Rick
get hold
Coles.
Of. Yeah,
right.
Rick Coles. And what else is in there? That's pretty much it.
So.
Theo Jack's in the back.
Yeah. I haven't
but
seen that book.
Yeah,
I've bought that book probably 10 times.
Yeah.
Stolen fucking 10 times. And I fucking refused to buy another copy of it. I just fucking absolutely refused to buy it.
But
motherfuckers, they just keep stealing it though.
But that was all I'd seen. So the names are in there, a few of those. And amongst that, there's some good stuff, like style-wise.
Right.
And but then I got him to tattoo me a couple of times, and as I started to get more savvy about tattoos that weren't just my idea of what was cool, but they were just good tattoos, I ended up asking him to do my back. And all the time I was getting my back done, he had this flash from Theo Mindell on his wall, and I just look at that. And at first, I wasn't totally sold on traditional tattoos. But as during that process, actually, as he started my back, was the time I started seriously deciding I'm going to tattoo. I'm nearly 27 years old at this point. I'm fucking sick of not being a tattooer. I'm hating what I do for my job. Even if I tattoo myself and nobody else, I had plans to tattoo my legs and just tattoo myself and then do my job to pay the bills and whatever. I needed to just tattoo. That happened around the same time I started my back. And it ran kind of parallel, my tattooing myself and then some friends. And as I was learning to draw to tattoo for tattoos and occasionally doing odd ones on myself, realizing what didn't work, Theo's flash made more and more sense during the 2.5 years it took for Steve to finish my back, and I could only do it when I could afford it and whatever.
Right.
And that's the long version of it, getting from me noticing tattoos seriously to doing some. But I I was too old to do an apprenticeship, and no one would give me one anyway. And I'd done a few tattoos on myself and a couple of friends. No one was interested at all. I'm like, okay, I'll just keep tattooing myself and then my friends, and then I got into their friends, making a hell of a lot of mistakes, tattooing once a week, sometimes do two small tattoos in a month. Getting really frustrated.
Hard to learn two tattoos.
Yeah, exactly.
Hard to retain any information.
But I was doing a lot of drawings, and I was trying to draw big things that I couldn't. But I was trying to. I was trying to draw Japanese tattoos because that's what I saw in the books when I was 10, as well as the cock and balls. But I saw. I saw Japanese, and that moved me. That kind of made an impact, and that was always there, so that when I wanted big tattoos, I wanted Japanese, and there was no one could do it until I saw that some that Steve Byrne had done. I was like, I'm ready now, you can do this, I want it. So scratching away in my house, fucking up my friends and myself and whoever had come by, and one of those people turned out to be Valerie. I met her somehow. Actually met her, a friend of mine, Soap, has a Lab Monkey tattoo in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
I think you've tattooed Soap, maybe?
Kneecap.
Yeah, he tattooed a panther on his kneecap.
And holding an eyeball in his mouth.
At the London convention. Yeah, he owns a shop. He was the first person to take the leap to trust me. To go, yeah, well, you know what, I'd show him some work, and like, you can come to my shop and do a week if you want. So, fuck, really? So I went there, and that's how I learned how to speak to not just customers but strangers.
Speak to strangers.
Because I was used to speaking to friends. Like, hey, what do you want? We'll drink a cup of coffee and stroke the cat, and then we'll go out and tattoo you. Went to his shop, learned a lot there. He was gracious enough to trust me. And then I used my first decent machine, half decent machines there. Actually, the first nice machine I used was one of Juan's that he had, so that was pretty cool. I've since managed to get one of them from that time. Then a guy who Valerie spoke about in her interview earlier was opening a shop, and he needed a tattooer. He asked two tattooers. One of them said no. A girl called Rebecca Marsh she's in Essex, just outside London. He asked her, and she was like, I don't want to work in the north of England. I don't think it's grim. The north, it's the north of
grim in the north of England.
There's a phrase, it's grim up north. And the north of England is, as I understand it, like the deep south of the States. It's just hillbilly central.
Really. Oh, really?
There's fuck all there.
Oh,
not really. People hate me for saying that in an interview, but there's not a lot there. Unemployment's very high. There's not a lot to do, there's not a lot of customers, whatever. As much as I love it, I can't live there. So this guy was on the show, I was like, oh, well, the girl doesn't want to be there, and she said, this guy, Stewart, give him a chance, I'll give you his email address. He wasn't impressed that I was working from home, but he was impressed with the way I talked, I think. I talked my way into a job, and it turned out I was opening the shop, and I was like, I don't know anything about tattooing. I'm opening a shop with this other guy, Les Barlow, you know, Les Makepeace. We worked together a little bit. He got canned from that place. I'm not sure why, but he did. Then Valerie, I asked her to come down, and she said in her interview, I presume her interview's going to go up before mine.
Yeah.
So that's all done. And then we worked together, and that was super cool to see someone who A, could draw really well, and B, give a shit.
Right now,
and
sure.
C, was eager to learn. I was like, wow, but she can draw better than me, so I better fucking try. And we kind of grew a bit together, and then the opportunity came. Got invited to Frith Street to try out, and that was the start of my professional tattooing career at Frith Street, I think. I may have missed some bits out.
There's obviously like a point when like you shit or get off the pot, and it's
That point was when this guy was like, "I'm going to open this shop," and I was like, "Okay," because as he was opening, before he was opening the shop, I was working 40-hour week, 45-hour week, tattooing at weekends, and then I kind of quit my job and said, "Look." The job I was doing, the graphic design job, he couldn't replace me very easily, just because it's hard to find graphic designers who understand what they need to do, like it is hard to find counter staff in a tattoo shop. You know, they all want to do something else, they all want to do their ideas of what it is, they don't do what's needed. So I helped him find someone, I trained a couple of people up for the specifics of that job while I was also opening this tattoo shop. So it worked a lot, and that was the point, shit, I'd get off the pot. Which coincided with the London convention. So as I went to this new shop, the whole world of tattooing was opened up, and I could see all the people I'd read about. And I could see you tattooing from a battery pack. And I'm like, why the fuck are you doing that? And I saw that people were using the same hand motions tattooing that I was using, but their tattoos were infinitely better than mine. So that meant... it was my fault. It wasn't the equipment.
Right.
I'd have to figure out why I'm still doing this. And that guy's doing this.
Why Mike Wilson had a saying. Obviously, he didn't create the saying. But he says the saying. He says, the Indian, not the arrow.
Yeah.
And I'm sure. Like, fuck, man. That is so fucking true. Like, yeah. It's true. That's We're it. All using the same shit. Yeah. Well, you can say what you will, but all of us using the same
all
shit.
All the same shit. And then that took me to... Frith Street, and then I was not big headed about it, but I was like, oh, maybe if these guys have asked me to come work there, maybe my work's better than I thought it was. And then I got to Frith Street and realized that wasn't the case at all. My work was worse than I thought it was, and I didn't think it was all that. And everybody at that shop was killing it. Everybody was really good, and I was terrible. And I couldn't even get a tattoo to... Well, not, I could get it to stay, but that was half the problem sometimes. It stayed a little bit too much around the line. Made some messes and had to learn quick. And Valerie and I have said a few times that Frith Street is kind of like boot camp. It's like going into the military and you're thrown in the mix in this tiny little basement and there's awesome people all around you. Everyone is doing the best they can, and then a guest comes in, then it's convention time, and then there's literally often your heroes coming in. I remember the first time I met Chad, and I remember it being Bert Crack, but Chad tells me it was someone else, and I was really stoked that I got to do this clipper ship as a walk-in. You know, when you book in, someone to clip a ship. I was like, this is amazing. It's not a squirrely little daisy chain around a wrist that it's incredibly difficult to tattoo and I make a mess of it. It's a clipper ship. Something cool. I want to take a picture of this. Lined it, sweating. All the guests started to come in and I started to shade the sails. And then Chad stopped and watched me. And Bert Crack stopped and watched me. I remember it being Bert. And they were the guys who I knew to be really good at that style of rough shading, was stood watching me. And I was shitting my pants. I'm like, trying to shade. Stop watching me. And a couple of years later, or maybe it was a year later, I was doing a dragon and chrysanthemums on a guy's leg. And he'd been a regular, he'd come back, and I was kind of comfortable with him and not totally stoked on the drawing or anything. It was as good as I could do, and I knew it was. To my understanding at the time, it was as good as I could do. And then Alex Ranke and Vito de Marvel walk in, and they watch me do this dragon, and Vito's watch me doing these chrysanthemums. I'm like, shit, man. It could only be worse if it was Philip Liu and Horiyoshi stood there.
You're right.
You know,
Horiyoshi looked at your book the following year.
Yeah, and then literally, it's like being asked to join your favourite band. It's like being asked. It's like Tony Iommi saying, "Hey, come join Black Sabbath." I'm like, shit.
But you have the insight as a person to know that I would give them not the arrogance to think that you have it all under wraps, which is a common trait with people with the artistic qualities. They generally run with a little bit too much of an ego.
Mm-hmm.
And you obviously used it as fuel for to get your ass moving, right?
At start, it was I didn't want to get fired. I'd move down. I grew up in a small town in the north. Moving to a close city was a big deal. Being invited to live and work in London was a huge deal. And I literally lost all my old shit. All those tattoo magazines I've been saving for 10, 15 years, being with some of the stuff. Not necessarily severing ties with old friendships, but having to let them fall by the wayside. Literally sacrificing your life to make this work.
Right.
And then going there, and I was like, I need to have enough work. I need to learn to tattoo better so I don't get fired and sent home. Because if I go back home, I can't tattoo anymore. I'll have to just work on a farm. I'll have to... You can't taste that and then be kicked out.
Right.
So, luckily, Valerie and I living and working together, we push each other a little bit. And I think... A little bit, she's laughing at me. But I think, luckily, the weak points in my skills happen to be some of the high points of her skills, and vice versa. So we can help each other. That if I'm more concentrating on the layout and the silhouette of a tattoo, she'll look at it and go, why is it cross-eyed? And I didn't even notice it was cross-eyed, whatever it is, because I was looking at the silhouette and movement and the rhythm of colours or shading or whatever. And hopefully I've been able to do the same thing with Valerie's, that she'd be looking at the detail and the texture, and I'd be like, kind of got no silhouette. So we help each other a bit and talk a lot about this. And because we were both terrified of getting fired, not being good enough to work and to earn this privilege to be around these people. And I still kind of feel, it's weird sat here just talking quite frankly with you, because I feel like a child at the table at an adult's meal, particularly the convention just gone, Tacky's convention last weekend. And I was like, I feel like I just should just sit here and keep my mouth shut, because someone's going to realise I don't know shit.
The jig is up. I feel like that all the time. Yeah.
Just
22 years later, I feel like any minute someone's going to jig me up, and I'm going to have to cut and run. And I'm going to go back to being a butcher. They're all going to know.
Yeah.
No.
I just feel like totally like a child at a table full of adults. And all the adults are talking, and I'm sat there, wow, this is so fucking cool. I'm getting to see all these people that I look up to, and some of them remember my name. And then occasionally someone goes, oh yeah, I saw your work, and I feel myself flush. Fuck man, they see my work. He's going to realise every bit I stole from him, every bit I stole from his friends, and every bit I did wrong, and every bit I didn't understand. And hopefully,
but that never manifests.
I sweat and faint.
It's never meant.
But no one goes, hey, dickhead, you stole my rose. You know?
No.
Even though the
it's not their rose, though.
Exactly. That's a different thing entirely. I've heard that. I've had that leveled at me once or twice. That's where you did that leaf was this guy's leaf.
Really?
Because it's on this flash from fucking 50 years ago.
Exactly. He just posted it on a fucking...
Yeah.
On the internet,
yeah.
And someone's fucking claiming it as their
own. That's another thing.
Yeah, but it's not... I mean, there's nothing... And this sounds jaded to say this, right? And I realize that this sounds fucking retarded to say it all that. But I kind of feel like there's nothing I'm going to do that hasn't been done. Because I don't think that I tattoo in... I'm just talking about you personally. I don't think that I'm not doing tattoos with fucking machines made from outer space. I'm not doing fucking crazy shit. I am literally every day reinventing the wheel.
Yeah.
I don't think so. I mean, I think I have my own artistic style to it, but I don't think that I'm going to shade this skull and eagle different than, you know, in some newfangled way that somebody's going to be like, I have never seen an eagle wing shaded like that before.
It wouldn't be an eagle wing.
Right.
It'd have to be something else.
Exactly. It'd be like, man, nice parrot.
Nice.
I love the markings you put on the parrot. I've never seen a brown parrot.
Once I had that realization, it took a while because I was kind of lost. Like, what am I going to do? Do I have to invent a style? Because I'm not clever enough to invent a style. I'm more of a, I suppose, maybe an analytical thinker. The craft of it's more important to me. That each time you do it, you try and do it better or faster or smoother or with more grace. Or just faster, whatever, you know? And that's how I approach the work I do. And I know people around me, particularly Valerie, doesn't. It's not the craft side of it, it's just, there's just new shit all the time, and new flair coming to it. It's impressive to see, but I just try and do it cleaner, better, faster, and hopefully that works.
But the technical part of it is extremely important.
Yeah.
Even
just the design side of it, like how can this design be clearer?
Right.
Well, how can it fit nicer on the body? Why was this rose there and not there? Or why was this panther facing that way instead of that way?
Right. Carrying the way that your eye tracks over looking at a piece and what's going to stand out more than other things. I think a lot of people in tattooing don't understand that at all, though. I mean, I don't think there's a lot of people that don't. They just literally stick shit together.
Like you said, you're not doing anything new, but that is something that's very prominent in your work, that you understand those things, that you understand the layout and the...
Sometimes.
You understand the layout and the, not sure the rhythm, but the contrast of every shape, that every shape in a design needs to stand out from the shapes around it.
Right.
And so it doesn't just end up being a mush.
Eddie Deutsch.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I was saying, I learned it from there. I worked with Eddie Deutsch, he would walk by and he never was forthcoming with any information. He would never just give you the whole fucking thing, which would drive me crazy. If you've ever met Eddie, and anybody that knows Eddie knows that he's not known for giving you a straight answer. He always leaves a little tail end, like, hey, did you want to get dinner tonight? Yeah, man, we'll see. Maybe.
Yeah.
What the fuck? but he would walk by and be like, hey man, you know you don't have to black shade everything.
I'd
be like, fuck. A, he's telling me. In my head I'm going, he's telling me I just fucked this tattoo up. Like, fuck. And then realize in the middle, I'm like, fuck. Well, if I black shade everything, I'm putting everything on the same value.
Yeah.
Right? I'm not separating these images the way they were separated. So he was single-handedly the thing. Like, and would point out, not everything falls on the same line.
Yeah.
Nothing should ever fall track on the same line. It never should be. And he drew this grid once for me, which I was like, whoa. He was talking fucking, at this point, he's talking science, right?
Yeah.
Like, he's drawing this grid and he's all these spot crossings, and he's laying it over the top of my drawings. He's like, see, this is falling, this is going the same direction as this is going. You need to break these things up. And I was like, holy shit. And I just felt like a child.
Yeah.
At that point, I felt like a fucking, like I had been tattooing for probably almost 8-9 years at that point, and I felt like at that point I had to start all over again.
Yeah. Fuck.
And it was fucked. Like, I was like, I don't know anything. Like, I can pack a chunk of red pretty solid, you know what I mean? And I could get this outline in there, but that doesn't mean anything now. Now I just felt like everything I had done was futile and stupid, and I needed to start over again.
I had the same thing with Ian Flower from... He owns a shop called New School Tattoos in Epsom, just near Epsom in Ewell Village. He used to work at Fifth Street. He used to work at Interu a long time ago, about 5-6 years ago. And he does a similar thing to me. Even though now we're friends, we've grown to be friends, we hang out outside of tattooing and we've been to Japan together, and he does awesome Japanese work. He does the same thing. He'll tell me one thing at a time, if he thinks I've earned it, I'm presuming. And I remember doing the same thing. Doing a sleeve, a skulls and roses, and I've done some background clouds and things. Done all the background, all the skulls. About to do this rose red. I shaded the rose like I do a shaded rose. And you watch me do it, and I went, didn't need any black in that.
So, right.
Whoa, what? Yeah, it just disappears in the background, doesn't it? Fuck. But he just says everything. Like you said, Eddie give you like the science of it.
Right.
Ian had just said like it was the truth. So he just didn't need that, did he? Fuck, no, I didn't. Holy shit. And he's done that numerous times. I remember told a few people at the weekend that I've met him. One of the first times I've worked with him, I did this peony inside a guy's arm and did some waves over it. And I was fairly happy with it. I was still nervous about being new at the shop and working with someone I look up to immensely, who's tattooed me, who I just feel like a child at the adult's table still. And I'm like, okay. And he looked at it. What did you think of that? And I was like, flowers okay. Waves were shit. It's like, okay. Thanks. Why were they shit? No, they were just shit. But okay. Asked him a little bit more. When there's no one around, he was like, oh. I think he just got sick of me pestering him. He was like, look, got a napkin out with just a piece of kitchen roll and drew a wave. Yours was like that. It goes like this. Look at Hokusai. What the fuck? Why didn't you look at Hokusai? Why did you think you could just draw a wave? I just thought you just drew a wave. He drew it and then showed me that this bit was as important as if not more than this bit. We didn't break it down. He just showed me his and mine. And this is right. This is fucked. Okay. So I didn't do waves for 6 months. And I was like, okay, I can't do any waves. I've got to... Someone will come and they want a sleeve or half sleeve or whatever, biggish tattoo. Yeah, I want a carp. I'm like, how about a samurai? Something that doesn't need water. And I kind of avoided it, didn't put water in it. Because I bought a sketchbook just for water. And get the sketchbook, practice water, looking at different people's water, looking at Horiyoshi's water, looking at different painters, Japanese painters and printmakers and how they do water, different tattoo family style of water, and then just practicing. And a few months later, I wouldn't say I had a breakthrough, but something just kind of clicked a bit, and I started to feel the flow of the water, not just the finger waves, but the rest of it. And at the same time, I was doing a similar thing with dragon's claws. I couldn't draw dragon's claws, and Ian had helped me with that. And he tattooed my whole torso, and I've got dragon's claws here. So he said, drawing, peeking, trying to steal that. But it didn't really work, and he gave me a few tips with that, but I had a sketchbook just for claws. And then again, after 6 months to a year, something clicked, and then I didn't have to draw like that. Draw my own.
No, right, right. Claw.
And then Ian's whole approach was... whether he knows it or not, or whether he'll admit to it, is everything has a reason, and if there's no reason for why you did something, it's probably wrong and it's probably shit. If he goes, why is that like that? Why is this red? Oh, it's red because the things around it are blue. Then he's like, oh yeah, perfect. It's red because there was red in the pot. That's not right, you know. Probably not right. So once I started to apply that, I thought that my work got a lot stronger.
Right.
And then I could move on and start really learning how things work. And it probably took till maybe the beginning of this year. It's end of October now. Round about in January, I started to think, I've kind of got the hang of some of this now. I'm ready to go forward now. I'm ready to start making nice tattoos. It's not to insult any work I've done. It's not to say anything I've done on those people that are wandering around watching this video. Not that that's shit, but I started to feel like my tattoos now, in January, were better than anything I ever thought I'd be able to do, because I never seen proper tattoos as I was growing up.
Right.
I was like, wow, as if I could do this just by working hard and learning and trying, what else can I do? It's just keep going. Just keep trying. Keep my eyes open. Keep listening. See what I can do now. And I'll see where that takes me. But I feel like I'm only getting started. Kind of nearly, I think it's almost 8 years I've been tattooing, which isn't that long, really.
I think that the putting the work into it is a really big part of it. Like, I drew all the time. Ever since I started tattooing, I've drawn every day. Whether I've had to or not, I've drawn every day. I mean, if I'm doing little bullshit thumbnail sketches or whatever, I've drawn every day. Mike Wilson, when I worked at 2-2-2, would come and stay with me for a week at a time, 2 weeks at a time, whatever. A lot. He would come out a lot at this point.
Yeah.
He would travel a lot. He would come out. And he was the first person I ever saw that would just obsess on an image and one sketchbook.
Yeah.
And one time he came out, it was dragons. And he drew fucking dragon heads and drew dragons. And he stayed at my house for a week, and he probably drew 200 dragons in the time. Like, he drew fucking dragon heads, dragon tails, dragon claws, dragon horns. Like, anyway, you fucking think, obsessing on every part of a dragon. And I was like, fuck, that's how you do it. And I've always looked up to him and he's always so relaxed. He has this very relaxed thing about him.
Yeah.
He's always very relaxed. His artistic style is very relaxed, and he's seems very comfortable in his artistic form and in the process of tattooing.
Yeah.
And so I was just like, fuck, man. And then I just started buying sketchbooks, same exact thing, obsessing on the thing, like, I gotta do water, you gotta do this thing, and just drawing it all the time. So, at the 8-year mark, now you feel like you got this under wraps. You've got an understanding of it.
I feel like I can kind of set the counter to year one or year zero.
Right.
This is when it begins. Like, this is, I'm not looking to be known or anything, but I didn't want anyone, I didn't want to kind of publish, even though I have a website, and that was mainly to communicate with clients, but I didn't want to do interviews or anything. I've been asked to do interviews, mainly because I'm the guy that knows Valerie Vargas. I really like and I've been asked, but we've been asked by magazines before they even knew we were a couple, can we do an interview on YouTube? These two people at Frith Street who kind of were new and now are kind of, they've been there a while and whatever. And I said no because I didn't feel I was ready.
Right.
But I feel now I've set the counter at zero. And I might be ready in a couple of years to show, partly because I've ended up doing big work, sleeves, back pieces, whatever, whether I should have or not, it's how it's worked out, and I've got to work with that. And that stuff takes time to do.
Right.
So you can't go, oh yeah, come back in 6 months, I'll finish 3 bodysuits, 10 bodysuits, it's not going to work.
No way.
And it takes time to learn like that, and it takes time to become somewhat accomplished at that. So turn things down, and I just said, no, I'm not ready, you know, I'm not.
Which is completely opposite to most people's thinking. I mean, most people are like trying to get it out there, and you're like, no, I'm not ready, I'm cool.
That's for magazines and maybe video interviews or whatever, but I'd had a website. I didn't really realize anyone looked at it other than people who'd been to the shop and picked up a card until recently at Tacky's convention here in San Francisco, because people who I'd never met had seen my work. It seems obvious because it's the internet. The internet's global.
Right.
But I was like, how did you come to even type in my name or click a link or whatever? That was for me just to show my new customers what I was doing right now. So they knew what to expect from me.
Right.
So they knew I can tackle bigger things now. I've done something like what you want. So you can ask me for this.
Right.
At least so they can tell when I'm capable of doing what they want. Like, I'm doing tattoos this big. When you want a half sleeve, wait until you see a half sleeve that looks accomplished or something like what you like, then come to me. And it was more of a communication. But it turns out that everyone's looking at Frith Street, and I didn't realise it was as big a deal as it was. And it was one of my favourite shops, certainly, definitely in the UK.
So how far are you booked out, is my question.
I don't book further than 3 or 4 months.
he's a smart one.
Yeah.
He is.
But I do still have a waiting list, and it's, I think, about 18 months.
Fuck,
which is
right.
Insane. It's insane that, yeah, 8 years tattooing. And I don't think that's because I'm good. I think it's because...
Clearly, it's because you suck.
Oh, yeah, of course.
You're terrible and you're awful, and people are going for that, like, ironic, shitty tattoo.
Yeah, I'm the hipster tattooer guy.
Yeah, exactly. I want it to look like, you know, kind of fucked up.
Yeah.
Just no color, though. I want it to look like someone did it in the kitchen.
That's what I'm
doing. Exactly. So I've heard all about you.
Awesome.
For sure.
So that's what I'm going for.
So 3 to 4 months, and then...
I have a waiting list of... I think it's 18 months,
okay,
give or take. So people come in, ask. That's allowed me to focus more on what I would like to do. I can put more energy into researching this kind of work, so they'll get that. People come in, what do you want? I want this, I want that, I want that. Maybe I'm not the right guy for you, because you're going to have to wait for this anyway. So maybe this guy sat next to me, who's an awesome tattooer, he can tattoo you in a month or two, and he'll do a great job, probably better than I would, so I can focus on the things I need to focus on. But if it's what they like, write their name in a book, and eventually we'll get to their name, and we'll call them in and make appointments, and but only 3 months at a time, so I can still travel. And then I don't, when a convention comes up that we haven't heard about, or I need to just go see my family, I don't have to cancel a bunch of appointments if I book super far ahead. I'm sure you know that.
That's why I do 3 months at a time. Because when I'm not very good at planning my life. I don't know what I'm doing in a year. I have no fucking idea what I'm doing in a year.
Yeah.
So I just started doing 3 months at a time. I had heard somebody doing 3 months at a time, and then I booked the 3 months, and then I stopped taking appointments, and then I tell them. The last month of that 3 months, I start booking for the next following, you know, like whatever, and that's how we do it.
It seems a good amount.
It took a lot of the anxiety out of it. So I was looking at my stuff, I'm like 8 months worth of shit or 9 months worth of fucking appointments, and then if I wanted to go somewhere, I'd have to move those people, and I'd have to do it on my days off before, my days off after, and so my whole vacation would be shot anyways, and so that seems to be better that way. And all of a sudden, people wanted to make appointments 5 times worse. So they couldn't make one, so you're telling me, sorry, we're not taking appointments right now. They're like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
I'll pay you more. You're nuts.
My life's not for sale. We've had that. I wasn't even that booked up. I used to do a fair bit of the tribal and stuff, because I like tribal. People aren't really asking for it so much. But like specific styles, not just spiky. Like, hey, have you seen Dusk Till Dawn? Yeah, you want it sticking out here and sticking out here. You don't care what's in between.
Right, exactly.
I wasn't really doing that, but if someone wanted a Borneo style, I'd be like, sweet. I'll get my Borneo reference out, get these books, figure this out, get it to work. But I had a guy come in. I want all this side of my body done. Borneo style. I was like, cool. Yeah, well, I'm sorry, but I'm booked for like 4 or 5 months at the time. I book you in. He's like, oh, I want to do it. I want to do it before then. I'm sorry, I can't do that. So I'll pay a double. Because that means you're buying my life. You're not just buying a tattoo from me. That means I've got to stay back after I've done a full day's work. When do I do my drawings for tomorrow? When do I do my drawings for next week? At the time, I was working 6 days a week, having 1 day off. So I can't tattoo you on my day off, because then that's not the deal. I'm selling tattoos, I'm not selling every minute of my life.
No way.
And for big tattoos, it kind of makes sense to work out a way to charge for time. But you're not buying time, you're buying the tattoo. We've just chopped it up into hours so that we all know what's going on. Because I don't have the mental strength to break up a 40-hour back piece into odd equal pieces.
Right,
other than saying, we'll just book you for this many hours and you pay this amount for this session. Sometimes we'll get a lot done, sometimes we'll get a little bit done, but it'll work out fair in the end. But I'm not into, I'll pay more, because then you want more from me.
Right. Even well, then they expect more. Like, then they feel like they deserve it.
How long is the time?
3 minutes.
3 minutes. Better
that's what we have left on that thing. 3 minutes. It's pressure. What do you do 3 minutes? How will people be able to get a tattoo from you? Obviously, you have an 18-month, like Valerie, unattainable tattooers. How are people going to get a tattoo from you?
The best way is to visit the shop on one of the days I'm there. My days are off Wednesday and Thursday. And they come in and say, I want to get this. And if it's something I think I'd be good to do for them, I'll say, yeah, let's stick your name down. We'll put you on the list. We'll get back to you when I can give you all my attention.
Right.
So that you can get one session every 2 weeks or once a month instead of getting tattooed every 6 months, because that sucks.
Yeah.
It sucks to do. You can't concentrate like that. And you're going to have to wait anyway, so why not schedule it so you get your finances in order to do regular sessions. Your tattoo will look better for it. People could email me, but I really suck at getting back to emails. And an international phone call isn't that expensive, really.
No.
If it costs $5 or £5, that still costs less than 6 months of your life, because it might take me 6 months to get back to you. I'm really terrible.
Once it's been more than a couple of weeks, that thing is in invisible.
So call the shop, call Frith Street, come to Frith Street, or conventions. I still do different styles where I don't just do Japanese work. I'm trying to cut down on the amount of black and grey I've done, just because doing endless sleeves of angels with mashed potato background, it didn't.
You mean clouds?
They said clouds, but they wanted mashed potato.
Right.
That thing. And they didn't want anything new, they didn't want a different reference that I was excited about, they just wanted.
Right.
They want David Beckham.
Exactly. My only two tattoos I've ever done in London, and working at a tattoo shop, one of them, the dude brought a picture of fucking David Beckham in. I was like, fucking really? Are you fucking serious?
So
and then the other tattoo I did was a fucking Japanese animation girl. I was like, come on! I'm like,
well,
fucking
London,
Christ! Like, all right.
Come on. Show me an eagle.
So I cut down a bit of that, but I do mostly what people want and choose a bit, but that's how they get tattooed by me.
Is there anything you want to add or throw in there?
I don't think I've thanked Dante from Frith Street. I think everything that I have came from him in one way or another, and he's responsible for that.
Nice.
And I'll think I'll be maybe indebted to him forever. I've kind of thanked Valerie. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for doing this very much.
It's
a pleasure.
Thank tattooing for making me work. Thanks customers. Yeah, without customers we wouldn't be doing it. But
true.
The life I have is because of tattooing. The work I have to do is because of tattooing. But I get to draw skulls and snakes and for a living.
Right.
That's how every 12-year-old boy's dream. It's like occasionally you might get to draw a tank. Or someone being stabbed on an airplane. Yeah, it's fucking awesome.
Exactly.
But there's a lot I probably should have said and didn't. But as long as I thank Dante.
Well, if you say it all now, then in the couple of years when you decide to actually do another interview, then you would
when
have nothing
the
to say.
World is ready for my opinion.
Yeah, then people will have to. Well, thank you very much for doing it.
Thank you, Scott.